What next? 1 Corinthians 11 is where we are. And it begins with one of these passages that Paul gets a bad rap for. A lot of people think Paul was against women in ministry, against women in leadership at all, and had this idea that women should just be submissive and do whatever the man says. He did not feel that way, okay? He was a very strong proponent of women in ministry, very strong proponent of women in leadership, but he also was a strong proponent of the culture in which he was in and making sure, again, the idea not being a stumbling block, the idea making sure that you become all things to all people, that in the culture, in the context, in the city in which you serve, that you are aligning yourself with values of that city as long as it's not going against the word of God. And so here, propriety in worship, he's talking about how women should be under men and how everyone should be, you know, taking their right positions and have their head covered and long hair, short hair, this and that and blah, blah, blah. What it came down to is cultural context of where they were, the city they were serving in. He didn't want their witness to be devalued and dismissed because they refused to abide by cultural values of the place that they were at. As weird as it sounds, it would be like if I decided to just start preaching without pants, because you know what? Everything's permissible. The Bible doesn't say have to wear pants. But what's gonna happen if I start preaching without pants? Well, then Pastor Gary's gonna have to write a letter to me to say, put some pants on, and in 2,000 years, everyone's gonna say, you have to wear pants when you preach. Now, here's the crazy thing. You don't know if I'm wearing pants right now or not, because you can only see me from here up. So who knows what's happening? But here's the thing, okay? It all comes down to culture and context, where you are right now. Are you willing to abide by the culture, the context of where you are in order to best reach the people that you are trying to reach and serve where you are? So he goes on from there, begins to talk about the Lord's Supper. Remember I told you he was gonna dig into this. He addressed it briefly before, now he's getting right into it. He says, in the following directives, I have no praise for you. In other words, I'm here, you know, I've been addressing these issues. I've been hitting you head on. We've been talking about contentions, talking about divisions, talking about all these things. I've had to really, really, really just lay this whole thing out. And now here, I have no praise for you in this. For your meetings do more harm than good. Yikes. Imagine hearing that as a church. Your meetings do more harm than good. In the first place, he says, I've heard that when you come together as a church, there are divisions among you. And to some extent, I believe it. To some extent, I believe it. He says, he's been doing nothing but addressing the divisions and the issues, right? He says, to some extent, I believe it. He says, no doubt that there have been differences among you. So which of you get God's approval for when you come together? It's not the Lord's supper you eat, he says. For you eat, each of you goes ahead without waiting for anybody else. One remains hungry, another gets drunk. Don't you have homes to eat and get drunk in? Or do you despise the church of God and humiliate those who have nothing? For what shall I say to you? Shall I praise you for this? Certainly not. In other words, he's like, this is supposed to be a solemn moment that you do in remembrance of Christ, and you are gorging yourself over here so that there's not enough for everybody. You're getting drunk over here. It's ridiculous. I have no praise for you in this, he says. In verse 23, he goes on. For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, saying, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, this cup is the new covenant of my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat of this bread and drink of this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. He's giving us clear direction for partaking in the Lord's Supper in a worthy manner. Not selfishly, not getting drunk, not gorging ourselves, but doing it to bring honor and glory to him. In verse 33, he ends with this, brothers and sisters, when you come together to eat, wait for each other. If someone is hungry, he should eat at home, so that when you meet together, it will not result in judgment. And when I come, I will give you further instructions. I leave you with this. Take some time to do a communion on your own today, and to do it in remembrance of Him. Not overindulging, not anything else, except to just take a moment of remembrance, like what Paul is talking about here. It's to never forget and never take for granted the price that was paid and what was done. What next? It's the body and blood.